Okay, hi everyone, and welcome to our 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, I can't remember now, time is flying by, live interview, Meet Your Dealer series, and this afternoon for me, this evening for Dan, we're welcoming Dan from New York. He is the owner of Stellar Home Audio, and he has as a hobbyist in the industry, let's say, but now he's a up and coming very strong dealer in New York. So first of all, let's start off with knowing you a little bit, Dan. So if you can tell us a little bit about yourself and your experiences as a hobbyist, and then we'll take it from there. It's all down to you now.
All right, thank you, Oz. So I've been in this hobby for a very long time. It's been a total of about 25 years. I started back when I was actually in high school. Right now, I'm actually 40 years old. So I started in high school when I was about 15 years old. And I remember a bunch of my friends and their parents at the time had this really cool stereo system that they said was called Bose. And I'm like, wow, what is this Bose stereo system? And I would hear it. And I'm like, wow, these tiny little cubes would sound amazing. And it just piqued my interest. So at the time, I really didn't have much money at all. So I went to my local Circuit City store. I don't know if you remember that store, that they went out of business. Mm-hmm. But I would walk through the store and see what I could possibly afford. And I remember seeing a pair of Technics speakers, and they had a sale. It was basically the pair for $60. And I said, all right, I think I have $60. Let me check when I go home. Got home, got my $60 plus tax. I went back there. I picked up the speakers, and I'm like, wow, these actually have pretty good bass. I didn't really know what was good sound at that point, but I knew if it had some good bass, it must be good. So it basically started with that simple pair of Technics speakers. And then I got a little bit addicted to that store, you know, Circuit City. And I would keep going back because they had another brand that they said was supposed to be amazing. And that brand was called Polk. And I'm like, what is this Polk audio? I never heard of this before. And I would go in the store, in and out, multiple times over weeks and months. And I would listen to their pair of $1,000 Polk audio speakers. And I couldn't believe the sound. And I said, wow, this actually sounds out better than Bose. Like, I thought Bose was the best thing. And I guess just like anybody, you start with that little bit of an addiction, and until you can appreciate what good quality sound really is, then you start taking it further. And as I went through high school, I got into the car audio, and that's when I got introduced to JL, because at that point I loved Alpine speakers within the car, and I would put JL subwoofers in my trunk. And you know, I got addicted to JL. I mean, lo and behold, JL is now a pretty much a high-end dealer in the high-end audio industry now. But back then, they only catered to car audio. So when you start with that little bit of addiction, then I can start appreciating what quality sound was. So by the time I basically graduated college, I went to school actually to be a physical therapist, and I still do that now. But when I start developing my hearing skills on what's good and bad, and I actually had some funds to buy more of what you consider a high-end speaker, that's when I discovered Paradigm speakers. And at that point, you know, they were very good speakers for the money. I remember getting my first pair of Paradigm Studio 100s version 2. I remember those. Those
developing on what's good and bad, and I actually had some funds to buy.
So after that, I just kept going down through the hobby, and I went through numerous speakers, but that's when you pretty much figure out what's good and what's bad. And I got stuck in this little rut of, you know, first I would get some speakers like Dyno Audios that were good, but they just weren't transparent enough, and the highs were, they just weren't crisp. And then I went to Focal speakers, and those were too bright for me. So basically, you get on this little bit of a roller coaster of what's good and what's bad, until towards the later part of my hobby, when I started getting into even more high-end speakers, with, you know, Sonos Faber, Rados. I tried Borson speakers, and now the final brand I'm extremely happy with, which I'm also a dealer with, is the Audio Solutions speakers.
Okay, let's talk a little bit about the brands that you carry. Let's talk a little bit about the services you provide, and then after you've given us a little bit of a sort of walkthrough of your current organization at Stellar Home Audio, we will go into the details of your preferences and how you establish systems for clients, what are the needs, and we will go on to the first off, let's start off with your brands and your services.
Sure. Well, right now, I'm still in the process of growing and developing contracts with other companies, you know, to expand the brands I have. So right now, it's somewhat limited, but I'm only focusing on the top quality brands that provide really good service, and that basically they just outperform all other companies within the value perspective. So when it comes to amplification, Vitus Audio is pretty much my top pick and what I carry. When it comes to speakers, it's Audio Solutions. As far as racks, I deal with Symposium. I deal with a little bit with Lumen as far as streamers. And in terms of subwoofers, it's REL that I go with. And then with cabling, right now I'm dealing with Purist Audio, even though I will be more than likely developing contracts with Ansys shortly. And I'm still looking for other brands. And I also deal with isolation control as far as still points goes, for room acoustics with their apertures and isolation devices that you can put underneath each components to minimize the micro vibration that overall improve the quality of the sound.
Okay, and in terms of your services?
So when I was an audiophile as a hobbyist, I found my biggest trouble is when I would deal with a dealer, they just basically didn't give me the time of day. And if I wasn't willing to spend $100,000 on a setup, they didn't take me seriously. So just like myself, I started with $60 speakers. And then I eventually went up to buying a pair of $71,000 pair of speakers and a system that went from $200 that went to $200,000. So I know the value of a good customer. So my customer service, whether you're going to buy that $50 product or that $500,000 product, it really doesn't matter. Anyone who deals with me, you have my personal cell number. I will deal with you personally. I get back to everyone absolutely the same day, any emails or text messages. I can just be reached very easily. So customer service-wise, I definitely go the extra mile. And if you have any questions about manufacturers or something I may not know, I have no problems contacting the manufacturer to basically get all the answers that I may not know myself.
Okay, it's actually an interesting point that you make in regards to the attention that you get from dealers. And if I may add to your example, actually two of them, I am known to, when I used to be a dealer, I'm known to give the longest demonstrations ever. And my record, honest to God, this is true, is 9 hours.
Wow.
And at the end of that 9 hours, the customer actually bought a $2,000 a pair of speaker. So when I tell the story, everybody is like, you're crazy. But it doesn't matter, because that guy ended up buying $250,000 system 3 years down the road. So I think I really like the approach that you have, that everybody deserves the same kind of attention. It doesn't necessarily have to, your attention shouldn't be attached to the dollar value. And that's why I think this business requires dealers like yourself who are passionate about the industry, about the hobby, so that we can basically attract some more dealers, the more hobbyists into the business, into the audio world, let's put it that way.
Right, everybody's got to start somewhere.
Yeah, exactly. Everybody has to start from somewhere. Nobody is basically, unless you win the lottery, nobody starts at the Ferrari level, right? Okay. Let's talk about, since you have had a lot of experience from the bottom up with lots of gear, and you mentioned, and I would like to let everybody know that Dan is our authorized dealer for Vitus Audio and also Audio Solutions speakers in New York area, New York State. Therefore, let me ask you this. What do you think that differentiates Vitus from some of the other high-end brands that you have used in the past, or you have basically played around in your past, or that you have heard in the past?
So I've obviously had a lot of different amplifiers, preamplifiers. I've always actually went into components. I was never that big into integrated amplifiers because I never thought integrated amplifiers would sound that good, that you had to have your preamplifier and your amplifier. Then separates always sound better than an integrated amplifier. And that's where actually Vitus kind of proves me wrong, because it's actually incredible how they can combine that preamp and amp into one. You don't actually lose any performance whatsoever. And as far as quality, I mean, when I first heard the RI-101, again, for a $15,000 600 integrated amplifier, you would expect it to sound good, but not as amazing as it really does sound. Just to give people an idea, again, I'm not bashing any other brands by any means, but before I had Vitus, I had the AVIC C300 and the P300, so their preamplifier and their stereo amplifier. The stereo amplifier is supposed to be 150 watts per channel, class A, and the preamp is supposed to have, there's supposed to be an amazing DAC in it. Now, those two amplifiers, if I remember correctly, the amplifier, I think, retails for about $48,000. And then the preamplifier, I believe, was at 36,000 Oz?
Roughly speaking, yes.
Right. So now, when I compared the RI-101 at, it's what, not even a third or a quarter of the price, I thought it would sound, you know, decent, like going from a Marantz to something higher up. But I was actually really, really surprised that it actually beat that. I'm like, how could this be possible? It just didn't make sense. Then actually after having a conversation with you and explaining about their UI transformers and pretty much all the technology that goes into the Vitus amplification, it's truly amazing what they do. So when you compare Vitus to other brands, it's not just that it sounds better. You have to really hear it because it's not seeing is believing, as hearing is believing. I've had VAC amplifiers, tube amplifiers, and a lot of people are tube fans, and they like that lush sound, that smoothness. And I was a fan of it as well. However, I felt I had to choose between vacuum tubes or solid state. I love the bass, the power, the impact, the speed, the crispness and the highs on solid state, but it's something seductive about the tube amplifications that it just has that beautiful lushness to it. And I never found an amplifier that could basically do both. You either had to choose go solid state or go tube. And then I've done a lot of research before becoming a dealer, and that's before I actually contacted you, Oz. And the Vitus equipment, basically you combine those two together and that's what you have. How you get that impact, speed, beautiful soundstage, crispness. The highs are almost liquid and it still has that beautiful lushness within the mid-range. And the most important thing, which I place extra emphasis on, is I need an amplification and I need good speakers that do not produce listener fatigue because I like to listen to my music loud. I tend to bother a lot of people with that, but I enjoy it loud and I don't want any ear fatigue. Mm-hmm. And I listen to a wide variety of music. Again, maybe part of it is because of my age category, but besides the normal classical, I mean, I love Bach, you know, I'll listen to maybe just a little bit jazz, not a ton of jazz, but I'll listen to pop, hip hop, I listen to everything. And that's when some of those recordings, especially classic rock recordings, some of the high frequencies are, it's a little poor with that those recordings. So sometimes it could cause extreme ear fatigue with some high-end speakers. But when you use Vitus Audio, I mean, it's just amazing. So you can enjoy anything. You don't have to change your music taste based on your stereo system.
Okay. The next question was actually going to come from me, but we will come back to Vitus and talk about comparisons and what makes Vitus so special. I'll add a few things as well, but I don't want to keep our viewers' questions for too long. And the first question comes from Gregory. What do you love about the Audio Solution speakers, which was going to be my next question?
Yeah, it's actually a really good question.
A little bit of background to Audio Solutions. We started importing them back in very late 2018, and then showcased at Rocky Mountain in that year. And basically, we started establishing our dealership network in March 2019. So it's been in the market for a very short period of time. But since then, we have made some strong inroads into the market because the price performance of the speakers are basically unmatched in my own view. The Audio Solutions is based in Lithuania, and they're all handmade in Lithuania. And the rest, I'll hand it over to you to answer Gregory's question.
Well, it's a really good question. And a lot of speakers encompass various types of technology, either into their drivers or into their cabinetry, to try to distinguish themselves from the others. Now, Audio Solutions, one thing that I've learned from them is that they use their self-locking cabinet mechanism. So basically, the louder you play the speaker, the more pressure you put on it, the tighter it gets. So the better control you have, especially within the bass. But also, even their enclosure, they use basically different materials of different thicknesses, and they sandwich it. And I know they vary their... the density and the width of the material, somewhere between like 18 millimeters up to 50 millimeters. So basically each cabinet resonates almost at different frequencies. And when they resonate differently, they cancel each other out. They basically dampen each other. So it allows the drivers to basically reproduce the sound the way it was meant to be. So what I like about Audio Solutions the most is that they can play anything, any type of music, which is pretty much what I require. And I think a lot of people like. Most people don't like to listen just to one category of music. I mean, you know, jazz is great, but when you want to listen to rock, or for myself, if I want to listen to some hip hop or any type of vocalist, it plays. It doesn't have any mid-bass issue. The highs are very liquid. Never ever fatiguing, just very smooth, and the integration from top to bottom is pretty much seamless. Gediminas did a very great job within the integration of the drivers, that when you have a good positioning of the speakers, which by the way, they aren't that picky, so you can play some relatively close to the side walls or even the rear wall, and They still sound good, but once you find that real sweet spot, the imaging is just fantastic, and it's you can almost touch out, like reach out and touch like whoever is singing. Basically, I just love the sound. I've always been a fan of Silk Dome tweeters as well. It's just very liquid sounding, and it basically just comes down to how much I enjoy the music. And between fit, finish, and sound, I think they're pretty much the number one choice.
I'll add a little bit to that, if I may. In our first show at Rocky Mountain, I was playing the Figaro Line top of the line XL speakers, and they're massive speakers. They're gigantic. And they were literally touching the back, the front wall, as well as the side wall. So I couldn't have any space to move them around in a small hotel room at the Rocky Mountain Audio Fest. And I was really scared that it was going to overload the room, but it didn't. And one of the key attributes to Audio Solutions' easy placement is the horn-loaded tweeters. That makes them very room-friendly, because the horn loading of the Silk Dome tweeters, Gregory, by the way, they are Silk Dome tweeters, is actually making them both vertically and horizontally. Dispersion is much wider. Therefore, you basically have very, very little problems in placing them in the rooms. And also, you don't have to tow them in, because some speaker doesn't need to tow them in too much because of their tweeter, mainly because they don't have too much vertical or horizontal dispersion. You need to basically have them firing at your ears, which results into heavy tow-ins, and then you start having other problems, if you know what I mean. Therefore, Audio Solutions without those disadvantages becomes extremely room-friendly, and placing them is so easy. And once you did that, they just disappear. The second question comes from Gregory again, and I will pass this on to you. And there we are. What is the price points of Audio Solutions speakers?
Okay, so just give you a rough idea of some of the more popular models. If we speak more about the Figaro and the Virtuoso line, in the Figaro, the M, which is what I also have on display here, those retail for $7,500 for a pair. Then you have the Figaro L, which is $10,000. Then you have the Figaro XL, which is $15,000. Then if you go the next line up, the Virtuoso, Virtuoso S is $22,500. And then the Virtuoso M is $32,000.
To add to Dan's explanation, there are four lines of speakers. And Gregory, the entry line is called Overture, which varies for the bookshelf, roughly speaking, from $1,600 to their top-of-the-line floor standard in that series, $5,750 for a pair retail. And then above that, you have Figaro line, which starts at $2,500 bookshelf and goes to the Figaro XL, which is almost 6 feet tall, weighs about 250 pounds each, and they are $15,000 in standard finishes, so between $2,000 and $15,000. Then you move up to the Virtuoso series, and in the Virtuoso series, we have only currently two models, which is the S and the M, which is 22.5 and 32,000 respectively. Let's talk a little bit about Audio Solution Virtuoso M's that you have behind you as well. It is quite a unique design for our viewers that Dan is going to explain. And then, if need be, I can step in and add a little bit more. But let's talk a little bit about Virtuoso M's, Dan. Oh, hang on. Hang on, everybody. We just lost, and we got him back. Yeah, momentarily we lost you, but you're back.
I think I just had a glitch in the Wi-Fi or something. It just dropped instantly.
Yep. Go ahead.
So the Virtuoso line, which I have the
version. We're talking about them.
So those speakers, they're a little bit more complex design than the Figaro line, where they use a box in a box design. And again, that's just to dampen all the vibrations within the speakers, just for better isolation and control. They have a little larger tweeter on them, also mini horn loaded. But performance-wise, they're on another little level compared to the Figaros. The Figaros are amazing speakers. Personally, when I listen in my own room, I usually wind up listening to the Virtuoso M. In the back of the speaker, they actually have a crossover that you can choose between three different settings. They call it moderate, balanced, and enhanced mode. And depending how you want to listen, for example, if you're listening maybe at a moderate volume late at night, you just want to listen to some classical music, you want it as detailed as possible, you switch over to the enhanced mode. And it just basically changes off the over the crossover settings. So you have maybe a little bit more emphasis on the tweeter, but it's just that much more crisp sounding. But again, if you want to change the pace, put some classic rock on that could be a little bit brighter and you want to play it loud, that enhanced mode might be a little bit too much for some people, depending on their room setup. And then you can change it to more of the balance or a moderate setting. So you have that flexibility of changing the crossover settings to fine-tune your setup based on your room, the acoustics, and the type of music that you listen to. Also, the speaker is just overall a little bit better refined. You have a little bit better micro details into the music, the micro dynamics. The bass is a little bit more natural, even though both of them have very good bass to them. It's just a little bit smoother. And I found it has a greater transparency within the mid-range. The vocals are just more lifelike, more natural sounding. And again, not to minimize the Figaro line, because the value that they have is truly amazing. But once you listen to the Virtuoso, I think it's going to be really, really hard to find another pair of speakers that would actually outperform them, anything under, say, around that $50,000 range. And I've actually compared it. I had the Borson 03 speakers in my living room, and those are $71,000. And they were very well broken in, a good like 1,200 hours on them. And I compared them directly. And when I compared that $71,000 speaker to the $32,000 Virtuoso M, honestly, there's actually no comparison whatsoever. It doesn't even come close. And people would say because a Borson speaker has that ribbon tweeter, it's supposed to be extremely light, extremely fast. It should reveal all those micro details. But like I said, hearing is believing. And if you actually listen to the Virtuoso and listen to what that tweeter, that mini horn load tweeter can do, it is truly amazing. And I found I got significantly more detail with my Borson, significantly more detail than with the Rados. And I had the D3.1s. And all these are, you know, speakers that are over double the price of the Virtuoso. And again, that value, but it's not just the value, it's how well it actually sounds is what got me addicted to that speaker.
Also, if I may add, Gregory, I've seen the size of your loft, which is quite big. But in the latest Rocky Mountain 2019, I had one of the bigger rooms, and the room was 30 by 30 by 14, which was quite challenging, as you can imagine. But I was playing the Virtuoso M's with the Vitus SIA30 integrated amplifier. And I wish you were there to hear them, because it's not an easy volume to fill with that kind of size, but it was just outrageous. We had after our parties, you know really well, Opec awarded us the best sound of the show award. Thanks to David for that. But when he came in on Sunday, when everything basically settled down, he said, "This is it. This was fantastic." So even with the Virtuoso M's, it is quite possible to play them in a very big environment. Let's move on to another thing. This is going to be the controversial side of things. Do you think cables matter?
So there's two things that I'm.
You can talk for a day, and I'll be out, and there will be a million questions on the right hand side of the screen. But there you go.
So I mean, obviously, most audiophiles like ourselves are already crazy enough to begin with, and I'm actually one of those crazy people that I will spend a lot of money into a good power cord. So do cables matter? Absolutely. And so does the power distribution matters too. This is the way I explain it to people I know, customers, so on. When you want to listen to a good stereo system, really all you're listening to is electricity moving a speaker cone in and out. So if that electricity has a lot of noise, a lot of distortion, it's not going to be able to control that speaker cone moving in and out properly. So the cleaner your electric, the less noise you have in the line, the better it's going to feed your components, which then can move that speaker cone in and out in a more linear fashion that has less distortion. Obviously, there's more factors that play into it, but just oversimplifying, that's basically what's happening. And I found, just based on my experience as well, when I started as a hobby, I actually did things backwards because I thought the speaker cable was the most important thing. So I spent all this money on really high-end cabling as far as speaker cable, and I would hook it up, and the system would actually sound absolutely horrible. And I would wonder, why does this sound so bright? Then I would actually change speaker cables to a warmer speaker cable to negate that brightness and that fatigue that I had in my ear. But the cables make a huge difference. I was just doing it backwards. The speaker cable really should be the last thing that you should be including in your system. I find everything starts from the wall. And even before the power cords, I find the cheapest upgrade you could possibly do is upgrade your receptacle that your whole system is plugging into. Get that maybe Ferrotech outlet, the gold, the silver, whatever one you want. That will have better conductivity, better connectors, which you have less leakage of the electricity. And it will basically prevent more noise from entering into your system. So I find spend that $60, $80 on a good outlet, a good receptacle. And then after that, get a good power distribution. Plug that into that outlet. After that, get really good power cords. The power cords, definitely, I find I spend the most money into as far as cabling. After the power cords, I would go with interconnects. And lastly, I would go with the speaker cables. And that's what I found gives the best results, the best sound. So I find that makes the biggest difference.
Everybody is just skeptical about the power side of things, but
they have to try it.
Well, I will give them a recipe to try it. It's actually very easy, and not many people know this, but we as distributors, we go to a lot of shows, and the show environments are terrible. We're stuck in a hotel for, I don't know, 5 days running, air conditionings are running. Everything is just basically all about noise in hotel conditions. And I have done this with a cable manufacturer in my room 2-3 years ago. And we basically finished the first setup day. And the system was just coming together. And then we left it running overnight. And we came back into the room in the morning, just before the show started, and I said, the system is not sounding really good. And he said, what do you mean? I said, it's like a little bit stressed. It's like, I don't feel like it's open enough. And he said, don't worry, we just set it up yesterday. It will come to life, at around midday. I said, okay, great, but we're going to lose everybody until midday. And he said, do you have a recipe? I said, I do. Let me show you. And basically turn everything off and then unplug the system from the wall, the main cable that you're using to connect your distributors to the wall, take it off, count to 30, put it back on. I forgot, initially before you do all of this, make a note, listen to a track and make a note of the volume level, then turn off everything, unplug it, count to 30, and then put it back on and bring the volume back up to the level that you heard the last track. Listen to it again. It will be night and day. You can do this at home. When you listen to your system, you basically try to register the sound. And then the next day, when you're listening again in the evening, when you want to listen at the same time, listen to a track first at a volume, certain volume level, then turn everything off, unplug it from the wall, count to 30, and start again. And you will know what I mean. It's actually mind-boggling. Let's move on to another controversial, or becoming controversial in audio these days. What is your favorite, Dan? Cobas or Tidal?
So I have actually tried...
I'm sorry. I lost you by mistake. Sorry.
Oh, it's okay.
Go ahead.
I've tried both Tidal and Cobas. I know a lot of people do prefer Cobas. Personally, I've actually tested tracks from both side to side. I play the same track and try to see if I can actually hear a difference. For the most part, personally, I didn't hear much of a difference at all. And from the few tracks I actually did hear a little bit of a difference, to me, it was actually Tidal that sounded better, which I know it kind of goes against what a lot of other people have been telling me. But for me, I find Tidal just sounds a little bit better. And I do like they have a larger music library. And again, because I listen to a wide variety of music, including more of modern music, Tidal just seems to be a little bit more up to date with that, and they have a larger selection. So I'm a little biased towards that, but for the most part, Tidal's the way I go. But I don't think it's really wrong to go either way. That they're both great services. You will still stream high res music, and especially if you have a good streamer, you really can't go wrong. And you know, just as a little side note, talking about streamers. With Vitus Audio, the RI-101, I tested their DAC streamer in that system compared to I have the Lumen X1, which is their top-of-the-line model. And you wouldn't believe how well the DAC and that RI-101 compares. And that's why I tell people, value-wise, you can't go wrong with that unit. I have not heard, maybe you guys can contribute, but... the DAC streamer for the SIA030, that one I actually haven't personally tried yet, but I would imagine that would be pretty amazing.
It is. To be honest with you, you know really well, and people who know me well know really well, that I'm not a streaming guy, as you can tell. I mean, Dan is like a 20-year-old, but I'm one of the old-timers. I still spin records and CDs. And I haven't really come to the conclusion that if you set up a really nice old style CD, and I'm talking Redbook system, I haven't heard a streamer that sounds better than that. But that's me, so don't attack me. But just to be a little bit more educated on this, believe it or not, Dan, just today I've got myself a streaming device. So I'm going to basically hook it up to my SIA30 with the streamer and then give it a test between Tidal and Cobas, and then I can actually vouch for my own opinion too. The question from Gregory is, what's the Vitus integrated price with the DAC? If I can just clarify that question for our viewers and for Benzer, Dan?
Yes.
There are two integrated amplifiers in the Vitus product lines. that actually has an option to come with a built-in streamer DAC module, DAC streamer module. There are actually four integrated amplifiers, but two of them has this capacity. One of which is RI-101, which is reference integrated. The first letter in any Vitus model that is designated to the series it belongs. So R is reference series. And then the next one up is the SIA-30, which is signature integrated amplifier, SIA-30. Those two are actually a built-in DAC streamer module option. And then I will turn it over to you, Dan.
Yeah, so the RI-101, that starts at 15,600, but the additional DAC streamer is $4,500. And that you order at the factory, they basically install that for you. Then you can go to the SIA 025, which is 25,200. The SIA 030 is 40,000. The optional DAC streamer module is 6,500. Then they have the masterpiece. That I don't remember what the price was. I just figured it was 120,000. So you need to be one of the big boys to get that one. But I'm sure it sounds incredible.
It is all of the specs of Vitus is actually it's 8-ohm RMS. So most of the specifications that Vitus publishes seem to be low compared to some of the competitors. If you can actually convert it to 4-ohm peak values that most manufacturers are using, then you're talking about 2.88 times of what Vitus is publishing to begin with. But more importantly, the reason why I said that the masterpiece integrated amplifier is 700 watts class AB at 8 ohms RMS. So it's 2.1 kilowatts at 4-ohm peak, but it is actually a little bit harsh or unfair, not harsh, but unfair to call it an integrated amplifier because it's a complete separation of church and state in one chassis. And for our viewers, just to give you an idea, you need three power cords to operate the masterpiece integrated. So one power cord is for the right channel, one power cord is for the left channel, and then one power cord for the preamplifier section. In other words, they have built a mono and a preamplifier in one chassis, and it weighs 280 pounds or something. I can't remember from the top of my head. Let's move on to the next question. Does the integrated have a DAC and a streamer, or is that separate? Well, I think we've answered that, Gregory. For the RI-101 and the SIA, the built-in DAC streamer module in the amplifier, if I understand the question correctly. I think that is the question, right? Am I getting something wrong, Dan?
I believe that is the answer to the question. But also just make note that, you know, in, for example, SIA 030, you could get that unit and then decide later on you want the DAC streamer module. And it's easy to upgrade that. It's just a couple screws in the back. You pop out. You can just slide the DAC streamer module right inside. So it's just very convenient. I know the RI-101 that has to be installed at the factory. So if you did want it with the DAC streamer module for that model, you'd have to know beforehand when you purchase it. But for the SIA, that you can upgrade at any time. And if Vitus ever comes out with another upgraded DAC streamer module instead of someone who has a streamer, a high-end streamer that may cost, you know, $15,000 or more, you would have to buy a whole new streamer. But for the SIA, you can just pop that module out, pop the new one in, and you're pretty much set to go.
Well, you have to basically upgrade the software via the USB at the back, and then you're off to the races. So you don't even have to ship it to us, the distributor, where we do have in the US a service center. Or you don't have to send it back to Denmark, or you don't even have to bother calling Dan. which Dan is happy to come and do it for you, absolutely no problem. But it's so easy. All you have to do is take out four screws at the back of the amplifier, slide the board in, put the screws back on, update the USB software, and off you go. And another keynote that we should add to this, Gregory, is the fact that we will very shortly, and when I say very shortly, in the next 6 months to 9 months, hopefully, we will have a full-blown phono stage board as well for the SIA30, only for the SIA30. So that will turn the SIA30 into a almost an all-in-one. And your follow-up question in regards to does the 30 refers to watts? Yes, that is 30 watt class A at 8 ohms RMS. And how much class AB, Dan?
And it has 200 watts class AB. So it's really
okay. And to add on to the SIA30, I think, forgive me for saying this, but I think we've seen this game before in our previous lives. When Intel was introducing all the computer chips in the motherboards, we were Pentium 1, 2, 3, and then it was just like going like crazy. I don't know where we are today, i9 or whatever. I don't know how many cores they're talking about. But if you think about how much of that computing power of those chips that we use as a regular user, and in my previous life, I've been a stockbroker, so I was running a lot of spreadsheets in the back of my 8-screen computer. Even then, I was using like 15% of the computing power of the chip, of the motherboard, right? So when everybody gets obsessed about how many watts is the amplifier, that's not really telling half of the story. Because, as I said, Vitus's specs are very, very conservative. So they will be more than 30 to begin with, but they're 8 ohm RMS. But more importantly, what is the size of the transformer and what's the capacitance per channel in the SIA30, for example? Then you tell us.
Yeah, I mean, well, the SIA30 has a 2.2 kilowatt UI transformer, and then it's basically 400,000 UF capacitance. So as explained to me in the past, it's almost like the power to stop the world from spinning. So it can control the woofer to there's no tomorrow, basically. And that's why I, again, being a fan of even hip hop music, I love the bass output of it, that this can, how well it controls the woofer. It just grips it like a basketball, and it does its job, basically. And it's truly amazing.
And also, Gregory, I was in Europe, in Belgium and France, before the pandemic, October time. So well before, according to the latest reports, the COVID-19 virus was even there, So, you know, I'm clean. But I've seen people running Apogees, which are like the problem child of the audio world when it comes to being power hungry with the SIA30s. So it's not only about the 30 watts of class A that it puts out, and also one of the biggest questions that we get regards to SIA, because the amplifier is class A to class AB switchable on the go, on the remote by the user, so it doesn't switch itself. And most of the time, even with very demanding speakers, clients are calling me up and they're like, Oz, we can't hear a difference. Oz, we can't hear a difference. I'm like, yes, you cannot, because, you know, as I told you, we publish our Vitus publishes their specs very conservatively. Most probably, you're not getting out of Class A, even if you wanted to, because even in the Class A B mode, the first 30 watts is Class A. So you need a really deaf, completely, I don't know, I can't even find a value, but 55 dB speaker, if that is possible, so that you can hear the difference. Otherwise, you know, it's just a walk in the park for the SIA30. Okay, let me ask you one last question, if we don't have any more questions. I mean, one last question on my end. Free to continue to ask questions to Dan. Here's the thing, Dan. What is the most important thing a newcomer should basically look at while they're trying to build a system? In other words, how would you hold their hand and take them to this journey so that not only they will appreciate what they're hearing, but they are also going to feel very good about themselves? This is only for the newcomers, so I'll leave it up to you.
So if I just go based on my own experiences in the past, where I basically did everything backwards, the wrong way. I remember about 20 years ago, I went to one of my local dealers and I said, listen, I have these small pair of Dyno Audio speakers. I just want to get a little better wire for it. And the guy said, listen, I could sell you a cheap pair of Kimber cable and, you know, it'll work. It'll sound good. But I want you to try this Nordos Blue Heaven speaker cable. I was like, yes, I know it's, you know, $300 or $600, whatever it was. And it's probably just as much as those small little bookshelf speakers that I bought. And he said, but I want you to try it. Just tell me if you hear the difference. And when I came home and I hooked it up, it was almost as my speakers were playing with a cloth hanging over it. And when I changed and I pulled that cloth off by putting in those speaker cables, I could really enjoy my music. So as a newcomer coming into the field, I find there's two things. Number one is the proper foundation, where you don't have to go crazy, but you want decent enough power cables. And then you want a good enough speaker that can actually have room to grow. And just give an example, the one thing if I go back to Audio Solutions is that they sound good with almost any amplifier. But for example, I first was breaking them in my home theater section with an Anthem amplifier, and it sounded good. I can't say it was amazing, but it sounded good. Then I put the RI-101 and I'm like, wow, this is truly incredible. And then when I got the SIA-030, it continued to improve. So how can a speaker that costs $7,500 keep get better and better with a better quality amplification? So that's why you have to choose the proper speaker, because you can get some speakers, like I had some Sonos Faber speakers, which they're good speakers. However, if you put a super high-end amplifier on it, it's not going to sound any better. It basically sounds the same. So you want to get clean enough electricity with the power cords, maybe the power distribution, and then you want to give them a good pair of speakers. Of course, amplification is important too, but you want to have room to grow in. Mm-hmm. And basically, it's just a matter of where they want to put money to divide it, where to invest more of the funds. I've always been a big fan of putting a fair amount into a good speaker, because all the other equipment can basically catch up as you get better. So if I would start with a new customer, I would basically put the little extra money into the speakers and then the rest into good power distribution and power cords. And I think they would be very, very happy. And as they upgrade their amplification, they're just going to love it even more and even more.
Yeah. I completely agree with you that once you get your foundation right, then the building blocks of finding out the differences between what you're testing or giving it a try at home, which is why our dealers are very proactive, just like Dan. And when you try it at home with a good foundation, you can actually hear the improvement. Most dealers will tell you that, oh, it's going to sound a lot different than what you have. Of course, as soon as you change a amplifier, a speaker, a source component, or whatever that case it might be in your system, you will always hear a difference. And difference doesn't necessarily mean it can be different. It can be for the worse. It can be for the better. But the only way you can basically find that out, if you were to basically have a good foundation of your system, and then you've lived with that system for a while, and then you say, let me see if Dan is right. If I put an RI-101 there, will it improve? And then you can see that it improves. But most consumers or most dealers tend to basically force you to change the speaker, the amplifier, and this and that and everything at the same time. Yes, you get a different sound. But is it for the better? Is it for the worse? You will only know 6 months down the road, and 6 months later, you might actually be very unhappy and you might lose a lot of money. So with that, Dan, I really want to thank you for your time, sharing your experiences with us. And for our viewers, Dan is, as you have seen and heard, is very passionate about what he does. And I am a true believer of supporting my own dealers, my authorized dealers, and Dan will vouch for that, like any other of my dealers. But I would urge all of our listeners in New York area to give Dan a call if they're looking to do something, because he's passionate about what he does. He's not after moving boxes. So I think that's the kind of a dealer that you want to establish a long-term relationship with, because I have been a client in this industry. As some of you might know, I have, in my previous life, I've been an investment banker, and I had a dealer that was holding my hand all the time. So once you have somebody on your side who will be with you throughout the journey like Dan, I think you're covered, and give Dan a try. Dan, I want to thank you a lot, and we'll see you again with other videos in the future, because we will continue to support you as your distributor for our brands. And thank you, everyone, for joining us.
I appreciate it, Oz.
See ya.
All right. Bye, guys.
Bye.